Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Gabriel India Limited Q1 FY22 earnings call. This conference call may contain forward-looking statements about the company, which are based on the beliefs, opinions, and expectations of the company as on date of this call. These statements are not the guarantees of future performance and involve risks and uncertainties that are difficult to predict. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Manoj Kolhatkar, Managing Director of Gabriel India Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mallika. Good morning, everybody. I hope you're able to see the presentation as well as I speak. Welcome, formal welcome to all of those who are present on call, and I hope that all of you and your families and near and dear ones are in the best of health and safe in these, you know, pandemic times. Joining me today on the call is Rishi Luharuka, who's our CFO, Nilesh Jain, our Company Secretary, and our investor relations advisors, SGA. I hope you had time to go through the financial results and the presentations. We had our board meeting yesterday and also our AGM. We did publish it yesterday itself. Firstly, I would like to update on our operations on the quarter. The first quarter, as you know, while it started well, I mean, the fourth quarter of last year was absolutely terrific. The momentum continued in April as well. Yes, we all know what happened in the month of, you know, March, April, and also May. The second wave, which was really devastating, because, I mean, everything was really adverse, and we saw the worst of times, as a country. What was different in this time shutdown was that, you know, every state had its own. In fact, not only every state, every city, everyone, every municipal corporation had a different shutdown period or different restrictions. Thereby, what happened was, you know, obviously we had to operate the plants. Again, I'm talking not only as Gabriel, but even as industry. We had to operate plants at suboptimal level because, you know, some customers were open, some were closed, and we still had to keep the show running. That was a very unique challenge that we faced during the second wave. In fact, all of our plants were kept running except Nashik plant because there was a mandate again from the Nashik Municipal Corporation to keep the entire Nashik shut for one week. June production, however, was fairly good, fairly robust, almost back to 90% of levels. You know, OEMs continue that normal level of production even into this quarter. Now, before we get into numbers, let me provide you an update on how the current environment is shaping up. Auto sales, as I said, has improved from July because all restrictions are eased, though not entirely. We are still seeing, like the city where I am in Pune, we still have 7:00 to 4:00 P.M. business timings for, you know, shops and establishments, and the weekend is closed. Again, we are seeing local restrictions being very different in each geography. The demand is strong. We are seeing a very healthy pickup in all segments except commercial vehicle, of course. Demand recovery is to accelerate in the coming months on back of improved sentiments, faster rollout of vaccination. We are seeing that is improving very well. Economic activity is also, you know, gaining traction. Overall demand for passenger car is robust. We are seeing huge waiting periods for passenger cars even now, mainly led by preference for personal mobility. Also, you know, after all these lockdowns, people, you know, there is a clear consumer sentiment to spend. You know, that's a human nature. There is low inventory also in the system, in the passenger car particularly. That is also creating a robust, I mean, definitely a robust demand as far as passenger car is concerned. Rural sentiments remain robust. Monsoon started well, sputtered a bit in between, but again, it's caught up very well. So I think that should be that should augur very well for our economy in general. Two-wheeler was a little below the expectation, but again, we are seeing that demand also picking up, in the month of July. Commercial vehicle, which I mentioned, obviously it is showing an improvement, but definitely still, while two-wheeler and passenger car is almost back to the normal days, CV is still, quite far away from the normal production levels, particularly the M and its CV segment. This, as you know, in during the monsoon, the construction activity, et cetera, is put on hold, so there'll be a little lull, but we expect the demand of CV to start picking up, let's say, from the month of September onwards. With COVID-19, we have been battling for the past, more than 1.5 years, and it has brought a spirit of resilience, adaptability, and togetherness in each of us at Gabriel and at Anand Group. We feel we are better prepared this time. While there are, talks about the third wave, nobody really can predict. But yes, as going by the predictions which we are, aware of, in all likelihood, towards the end of August or early September is what the third wave is expected to hit. The impact is not going to be as severe as they say, but yes, there are chances again of some disruption that may happen. We really don't know. It's anybody's guess. But as regards us, we are taking utmost care of all our employees and their families. We have ensured vaccination of all our team. Families. We have, done it at our cost for the employees. So that goes on. We have finished 94% of employees who have done their first vaccination. The balance, of course, is due to those people who are recovering from COVID. So there's a waiting period for them before they get the vaccines. Now, moving to the numbers, while I'm not referring to the presentation as such, but I'll just, since it is already uploaded, with the onset of the second wave of COVID, auto industry faced a lot of challenges. Despite that, we reported a top line of 453 crores and EBITDA of 25 crores, and PAT came in at 12 crores for the Q1 of 21-22. Indian auto industry faced severe restrictions due to the second wave, as I already mentioned. We started seeing recovery in demand from June onwards. So we will hope that this continues. As I said, the only if is the third wave. Otherwise, we see really a very, very good demand going forward. We have recorded a 19.4% year-on-year growth in EBITDA to 25%. Margins stood at 5.5% for the quarter. As I said, may really upset all calculations for all of us. Margins improved on account of the cost reduction measures that we have done despite this, and one big impact has been, as you all have been witnessing, is the commodity price increases that we are seeing, in the market, and these just go on unabated. Just to mention, the steel, cold rolled steel, which we use, or the hot rolled steel, which is the main ingredient for auto component industry or automotive OEMs. In March 20, when we had the first lockdown, it was about 45 rupees per kilo. That has gone to almost 82 rupees per kilo. And in fact, it's going further up in July. We don't know when this is going to stop. So we are seeing a similar trend in forging steel. We are seeing a similar trend in aluminium, in rubber, in copper. Every commodity that we have, we are seeing a similar, unabated price escalation. So this obviously is putting a serious challenge to us in terms of, the margins. We have a back-to-back with customers. Most of our commodities are indexed, and there is a lag, depending on whether it's quarterly or six-monthly. But yes, obviously there is, has an impact on the overall profit percentage. Moving on to the balance sheet and cash flows, we continue to maintain a robust balance sheet position with a net cash of 203 crores. We have continued our thrust on collections and are working to reduce our inventories. However, we have also, taken a conscious decision looking at what happened last year of, holding some inventory to avoid premium freight for the festive season. So that is a very calculated and logical decision that we have taken. In terms of CapEx, for the quarter, it stood at almost 19 crores, and the capital investment is mainly in the field of R&D, automation, line balancing, which is needed for the future. Coming to the segment-wise performance, in 2 and 3-wheeler, we continue to see good traction. 2-wheeler segment scooters improved significantly, even motorcycles improved by 160%, mopeds by 43% in this year. Talking about 2-wheelers, of course, what is the talk of the town is the EV, the EV 2 and 3-wheelers. So the trend is really catching up for mainly, I would say two reasons. One is the government subsidies, which are announced in FAME 1 and now FAME 2. And added to that, the fuel price increase, which is, the petrol has gone beyond 107 rupees also in some places. So this is really, pushing the adoption of electric 2-wheelers and 3-wheelers faster than probably what we expected. And there are a lot of incentives that each government is, offering. But as mentioned earlier, we have, got good orders with all the key 2-wheeler makers. We have got the order for Ola Electric, as you know, the launch is planned on August 15th. We have with Okinawa, Ampere, Ather, TVS Electric, and in 3-wheelers, we are with Bajaj, we have Mahindra, we have with TI, who are coming out with their 3-wheeler, we have with Kinetic Green. So all this is, already with Gibbet. So we are well placed. Basically that's the message that I'm trying to convey in terms of EV adoption in 2-wheeler, 3-wheeler. In passenger car, the EV adoption is still slow, and our penetration also is not honestly strong in the EV as of now. We are with the Mahindra EVs for sure. We are not on the Nexon EV, but the pace of adoption is a little slow, but our efforts are on to see if we can make inroads there as well. Coming to passenger cars, of course, on the overall segment, we had, we had lost out on this segment a bit due to some of our models going out of production, like the Wagoner and the Alto, and also the Omni. So this definitely, took some of our volumes away, but we have been working to build the business pipeline, which I have been continuously updating you on every call. Now, glad to share that our market share has increased from what had gone down to as low as 17% to now 21% in this quarter. And we have, this is going to go even further up because we have got a lot of new models, and particularly with Maruti, just to mention, we have got the new Alto. So this will help us increase. This launch is, of course, in 22-23, not in this year. We have got the new Brezza. Brezza is with us itself, so it's not incremental, but any new model comes with a higher sale, obviously. But one good new addition is the Maruti Jimny, which is completely new, in terms of volumes and model to us. So this is, again, with Gabriel. And we are also, of course, readying for the launch for the SOP of Mahindra XUV700. You're seeing a lot of advertisement on the TV on this for this particular model, very exciting model, and we are also offering our new technology on this product. So we are well on our way to increase our market share as was planned, and you are seeing those in numbers as well now in terms of the percentage increase. With the commissioning of our new tech center, which we have built in Chakan, state of the art tech center, we will be even in a better position to offer a better value to our customers and increase our market share further. Moving to CV sales, sales have picked up, as I said. Our dominant position continues. We only will have to wait for the industry to recover. But we are definitely seeing a better than expected recovery, I must say, in the month of July and going forward in the month of August, September as well. And from September onward, it will definitely, I think, it will be even better. Aftermarket continues to be a strong story. We are leveraging the brand Gabriel by launching new product lines. All our new product lines, like the brake pads which we launched and the drive shaft which we launched, are doing extremely well in the market. Very good reception received from the market on this front. We had revenues of almost 65 crores, and aftermarket now contributed to 14% of the total revenue. So this what used to be 12-13% has gone to 14%. So we are taking a very vigorous push on the aftermarket, both in exports as well as domestic. Coming to exports, which is you know, something that I want to share on a positive note with all of you, we are seeing, you know, very strong traction in the exports, and we are seeing our exports numbers, in fact, among the best that we have seen ever in the Q1. As you can see on the slide which is being shown currently, our Q1 21-22, our exports sales was almost 27 crores, which is the highest ever by a handsome margin, you know. So and this is only increasing. We are in the production mode for the DAF of Netherlands for the commercial vehicles, and in fact, as we speak, just last week, they have added DAF Brazil also to our kitty, and they have asked us to export to DAF Brazil as well, and shortly they would ask us to extend this to other continents as well, based on the good performance of our product. So this is good news. Volkswagen Russia volumes are very steady, and we are exporting almost 5 containers a month to Russia. So even that is going well. Even Yamaha exports that we do for the golf cart, this goes back to Yamaha Japan. This we have been doing for several years, but even that has seen a small pickup. However, the volume is quite small, but yes, nevertheless, we are seeing a pickup even there also. Now coming to the next slide, which is just one. So just the back, Rishi, can you? Yeah, electric two-wheelers, I already mentioned, so I want to suggest some figures for all of you, which are, you know, put up here. So we are seeing a good traction as regards, you know, Gabriel is concerned on this front. Yeah, next slide. We also did a, you know, just a mapping up from 2021, or actually if you remove 2020 because it's a COVID year, and we tried to map as to what is our growth compared to the industry growth, and we're glad to see that our growth, we have consistently outstripped the market growth in terms of percentage. I mean, our growth has been better than how the market has grown in this 7-8 year period. So that is the only issue there was passenger cars, which I've already told you we are well on track to, you know, reverse this trend as well. Yeah, next slide. So this is, you know, I've been sharing this Core 90 initiative, which is cost reduction in 90 days. This has become a theme, a backbone for all of us with weekly reviews. Yes, there are challenges continuously coming in terms of particularly commodity price increase. So this is helping us offset to the best possible that impact and, you know, remain in good health. Next slide, please. Yeah. So this is, you know, of course, the vision which we have shared with you to be in the global top 5 based on these 4 pillars. Exports, we are seeing good movement there. Domestic dominance, particularly in cars, we are now getting back, covering our lost ground. Scanning for opportunities continues as we speak. Tech center, I already did mention to you on the tech center part. So this is in short that, you know, what I had to share with all of you. Yes, we are seeing a lot of challenges in terms of, commodity apart. We are seeing challenges of the OEM itself in terms of semiconductor shortages. Yesterday morning, there was a news about Suzuki Motor Gujarat having to shut for 3 days for chip shortage. Similarly, this is being faced by Tata Motors, the Mahindra, most of them, though this is much lesser than what is seen in terms of shortage globally, but even Indian automotive industry is being hit now by semiconductor shortage, and this will go on, as they say, for close to an year, because it's a global shortage scenario, mainly arising due to the rise of digital use of every person on the planet, which has caused this shift in supply demand as regards the chips are concerned. But overall, I think the good part is all employees are safe and healthy, and we are all set to see and to cater to the increased demand, because we still see the demand being robust, and we are hopeful that we'll be able to outperform the industry in the coming quarters as well. So on that note, I come to the end of my opening remarks. I would request the moderator to begin the question and answer session, and we'll be glad to answer any queries that you have or take any suggestions that you have. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Viraj Kacharia from Securities Investment Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. First of all, congratulations for a decent set of numbers in such a challenging environment. I just have three broader questions. First is on the margin front. Even before the COVID, we've been taking various cost initiatives, and in the last 1 year, we accelerated several cost programs as well. So, I understand right now we are facing a lot of commodity pressure, but how should we understand the margin, sustainable margin profile for us, considering all the efforts we've been taking towards, costs and other measures? And in relation to, the kind of efforts we're also taking in terms of moving to higher tech products. So in the long term, if I were to look at next 2-3 years or 5 years, what is the kind of sustainable margin one should be expecting in the business? That is one. Second is in the EV part of the business, especially for two-wheelers, three-wheelers. Compared to ICE engines, how would our market shares be, in ICE, we see certain large players catering to in-house group companies. But in an EV world, how does our competition and market share, based on existing pipeline, is be? So these are two questions. Third, I have on export. I'll just ask after.
Okay. Thank you, Raj. So yes, on the margins part, unfortunately, we were also well on our track last year. We said we would. Our continuous aim has been to get to double digits. I'm talking about EBITDA. That has been our continuous aim. So we are getting there, but this commodity is really again, it's not only Gabriel. We as an industry, we thought that this will start easing off from April onwards, but this just doesn't seem to be easing off. And what happens is that even if we get a complete recovery from customers, it has in terms of the percentages, it definitely upsets the percentage. So again, these cycles will happen. It has to come down, maybe a quarter, 2 quarters, this has to come down. Then you start seeing the margins get back to, healthier levels in terms of, inching closer to double digits. So long term, if you ask me, if I discount these, short term aberrations that happen, our aim continues to remain, double digit. It is a challenge, but we clearly, with exports, aftermarket picking up, also, our passenger car improving, we hope that we'll be able to see better utilizations also. That is also very, very important for a company like Gabriel, where we are installed, we are built for volumes. So we need these volumes to help us. So I think we should definitely get there. Short term, yes, it will definitely not be double digits. I think even the margins around 8% will be good enough. Again, as I said, if anybody guess.
Just to follow up on this, when we say we have an aspiration of double-digit EBITDA margins,
yes.
Is it largely dependent on volume recovery? So is it a function of operating leverage or is it purely, is it also led by elements like product mix, either led by EV or higher share of exports, aftermarket? So can you kind of give some color on
Yeah, obviously the margin improvement, we have made a plan distributed across various levers. I mean, one lever, of course, very clearly is, you know, improving our exports and aftermarket, which I mentioned all along. Product mix in terms of, you know, our own TP commercial vehicle, if that segment improves, naturally it will be better. Railways, you know, is one segment which did extremely well in the year 1920, but after COVID it is, you know, reduced to less than half. So that has also, you know, so if that also happens, you know, because it's bound to happen. Again, I'm not trying to fly a kite here. The railway is surely going to recover. It's only a question of, you know, when. So when these things happen, improvement of CV, improvement of railways, we'll definitely see improvement in margins as well. So that's why I said, I think it's a temporary setback. What is important now is to lock the numbers, is to ensure safety of everybody, and to ensure that we continuously, you know, focus on improving market share. That's what is our plan as of now. Coming to your second question, which is IC units, the market share in EVs. As I said, we are focusing on two-wheeler, three-wheeler, because that's where action is happening. So as of now, yes, we are well positioned to improve market share, but, you know, we don't know how the market is going to move, because now Ola has announced, you know, 2 million per year. Whether that will happen or not happen is anybody's guess. So it's really difficult for us to say how much of this will translate into actual volumes and thereby our market share. But the good part is we have just, you know, hedged our bets by ensuring that we are there with all the key players.
Okay, this last question is on the exports part. If I would look at our journey, you know, we kind of have been trying to break into major export markets for quite some time. And last 1 year, we seem to, you know, got a couple of breakthroughs. So if I were to understand this better, you know, you talked about TAF having a possibility of catering to more wider plants. So how is the scope of exports, you know, moved for us, you know, not just for TAF, for other customers? How is the pipeline looking like? Any color you can share on that?
Yeah.
When we say DAF, what is the kind of opportunity one can look at, if one wants to look at that? Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so exports is, you know, actually it's in two parts. One is the aftermarket, one is the OE. So, you know, OE was, you know, not really, you know, very good. So that's where we are focusing on. It took, as I said, 5-6 years for us to break through. But, you know, if you remember, I had always told that, you know, once we unlock one good marquee customer, it will open up doors for the rest. And that's exactly what is happening. I'm happy with, you know, the way it's moving. We unlocked DAF. Netherlands, DAF Netherlands has unlocked, you know, Brazil, now probably Australia is going to come through, and some other continents as well. And within DAF world, now we have already got some other RFQs that we're working on. Similarly, you know, now that we have DAF, we are able to tell other customers that we are supplying to, you know, a marquee customer like DAF. So, you know, Volvo is showing some interest. So we are in an advanced stage with Volvo as well for a global RFQ. We are in touch for Leyland Global RFQ. So we see this happening. Yes, it is a little slow process, but this will definitely happen. Similarly, in passenger cars, Volkswagen, we started with, you know, just about a first order, I remember, of it was just to meet their, you know, some issue that they had online with other suppliers. We had just an order of 10,000. Now that 10,000 has, you know, converted into few lakhs of pieces, almost 3 lakh per year. And this we see again opening up doors within Volkswagen. So that's how it goes. I think we'll have, so the good part is it's definitely going as per plan. In terms of visibility, it's difficult to give you right now. But yes, we are in advanced stage working with two global customers for commercial vehicles for sure. And one big passenger car manufacturer as well.
Right?
One?
We talked about two global OEs for CV and one for passenger vehicle.
One
is in addition to the customers we already catering.
Yes. These are totally in addition to whatever we are talking about. So, you know, I'm sure you know, one of them will definitely come through. And I'm not even talking of other customers where we have got the RFQ. I'm talking of the ones where we are in advanced stage of discussions.
Okay, I'm back in the queue. Thank you very much and good luck.
Thank you.
We would like to remind participants that you may press star 1 to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Amarkant Gaur from Philip Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Am I audible?
Yes.
Good morning, team. Thanks for taking my question. Sir, what I wanted to understand was on the gross margin side, what is the mechanism of passing through the cost increases? I mean, what kind of contracts do you have with the OEMs and how often those contracts are renegotiated as far as pricing is concerned?
Okay. So, like I mentioned, Amar, I mean, we have a back-to-back arrangement with, you know, all the customers for a pass-through. The only thing is the period, I mean, varies. Somewhere it is quarterly, somewhere it is half-yearly, and somewhere in some cases it is also on a yearly basis. Otherwise, let's say steel increases us 10 rupees in the market, we get the entire 10 rupees back. It's not that we don't get it, but we get it with a one quarter delay. And then having said that, you know, we are also, as you know, we are also a proprietary item supplier. So there are some parts, some commodities which are not covered back to back because we also want, you know, to keep it as a black box. So some are not indexed entirely, but those are very small numbers. The large ones, which is steel, aluminium, oil, and rubber. These are covered back-to-back with suppliers, with OEMs.
Sir, would it be fair to assume that whenever these commodity prices turn the other way, the benefit will flow to us would be much greater in terms of what we have yet to collect from the OEMs versus and what we will benefit from the costs going down? Would that be a fair statement to make?
Could you repeat that?
So we, if let us assume that there is a one quarter of lag in terms of recovery,
yeah,
when the costs do start to go down, then is it fair to assume that you will have a double benefit of it, prices going down and greater recoveries owing to a quarter lag?
Yeah, obviously that lag effect will be there both ways, yes. Both ways. I mean, when it goes down, there's a benefit. When it goes up, and in a continuously increasing scenario, you know, it obviously is more adverse.
So again, sorry, I'm pressing on it a little bit. If the costs even stay at these levels, our margins should improve given the fact that the costs that we are yet to recover from the OEMs will start coming in a quarter later.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for that, sir. And the second thing is, in the last call, we had discussed about premium OEMs, our products being tested by premium OEMs like Audi you had talked about. Is there any development on that side? Or maybe any other OEM for that matter?
As I said, Audi, we have got an RFQ from them. Of course, we could not, you know, make it in terms of converting into business. We keep getting. See, the point is, Volkswagen has now identified us as a global supplier. So we keep getting opportunities even from Audi. That's the point that I had made. But let's say, talk about commercial vehicles. DAF Netherlands is like, you know, it's like an Audi of commercial vehicles. You know, that's where we have broken through. Volvo, similarly, which we are in, you know, advanced stage of discussion, is something we are supplying to Volvo India, Volvo Eicher, not Volvo exactly, Volvo Eicher. But Volvo is again a very good plant. In passenger cars, we have got RFQs from, I would say, only Audi, because Volkswagen is what is open to us. But no, we have not been able to convert them into business as of now.
Okay, that's great to hear, sir. Thank you. I'll follow back. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, you may press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Srivan from Unify Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good morning. Thanks for the opportunity. The first one is would like to know your comment on the margin profile towards the supply to in the EV segment. How would that compare with, you know, the existing two-wheeler customers, especially, you know, the supplies that we are going to do to Ola?
Yeah, Rishi, you want to take that?
Yeah, sure. Shivan, thanks for asking that question. So, while we've said that in the previous call also, that, you know, Ola is, as far as the product is there, it's different, but as far as the pricing is concerned, it's fairly competitive to the two-wheeler space. Given that we can't share details of exactly how it is, but it's fairly competitive.
Yeah, but on the margin front, we know the profile would be similar. Like, while the pricing is similar?
Yeah, it is similar, maybe even a tad better.
Okay, got it. And has the deliveries started to the Ola Electric, because they are looking to commission in the next few weeks?
No, it's still in the development phase. I mean, the mass production is planned, I mean, not in the month of August. It's just the launch, you know, the price launch that they're planning. The formal SOP is still yet to happen.
Got it. So second question was on exports. Given that, you know, we have taken, you know, 5-6 years to break even in the initial OE customers in the export market, for the new customers that we are looking to service, what should be the time frame we should look, you know, to start, you know, catering to these customers? How much it should reduce now?
In terms of export customers?
Yeah. So, for example, if you're, you said you're looking for, you have two global CV and one passenger cars, you know, customers you're in talks with. What should be the time frame we should look to start catering to these customers? I understand the initial customer, the first customer took about 5 to 6 years to break through in the export market. But going forward, what should be that time frame?
Okay. Well, I mean, like I mentioned, BAF, we had started with only one part that led to two other parts. So that, you know, has happened very quickly. So similarly, within the DAF world now, you know, DAF is part of Paccar Group. So you have DAF, you have British Leyland, you have this Kenworth trucks in US and Peterbilt trucks. So all of those are part of their profile. So obviously, you know, that time will be much lesser. Breaking into that, you know, that family of trucks. So it, I mean, it would definitely be much lesser. Similarly, even for Volkswagen, the time would be lesser within the Volkswagen world. But let's say I have to approach a completely new customer, not Volkswagen, then that time will still be 3 to 4 years.
Okay, got it. Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from Priya Ranjan from HDFC Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks. Hi, Manoj. I mean, my question is on the two-wheeler mix, or two-wheeler, three-wheeler, what we say is roughly around 65%. That is the annualized number, or I mean, broadly in our top line. So what will be the broader split between, say, motorcycle, scooter, and three-wheeler, if you can help with that?
See, the split, Priyanjan, will be mainly tilted towards two-wheelers only. As you know, two-wheelers is what is selling currently. If you see the numbers as well, let's say for, even if you take, you know, 2021, I mean, though it was a shorter year, but a total of about 2,40,000 EVs got sold. Out of 2,40,000, two-wheelers itself was about 160,000.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so the bulk is two-wheelers, and three-wheelers, of course, is also good. You know, out of the 241, I mean, cars is practically nothing. So it's 160 of two-wheelers and about 70 of three-wheelers. So that's the split, and that will continue. Of course, I'm not counting, you know, those, what do you call, three-wheeler contraptions that you see in the cities, in Gurgaon, etc. That, mm-hmm. you know, they buy completely, I mean, complete kits from China, or pick up from the spare parts or whatever. So I'm not counting those. I'm counting the ones which are reported in terms of three-wheelers.
But if, what I'm saying is between us, I mean, for our revenue, so what will be coming from, say, scooter within that?
I think most of it will be scooters. So if you see our own spread of customers, so Ather Energy, we are in scooters. Tremendous growth being seen there. Ola electric scooters, Okinawa scooters, TVS again scooters, Ampere is scooters. So all this is scooters. The only motorcycle development that we are seeing is maybe to some extent Revolt, where we are not a source, but we are in discussions with them. That's the only motorbike. But I see, you know, motorcycles may not, you know, catch up because motorcycles are more commuter or rural usage or pleasure biking. So EV may not be a right fit there. Scooters, definitely, you know, it's more of an intra-city unisex kind of model. Three-wheelers, of course, we'll see a lot of traction. So three-wheelers, again, I've already mentioned, Mahindra Electric, Anetic Green, TI Cycles, all are with us. TVS also, Bajaj also.
Okay,
so, yeah.
And then, sir, two-wheeler side, what will be our broad breakup between, say, motorcycle and scooter for us?
Rishi, you have that?
So give me a minute, I'll just pull that out and let you know.
Okay, yeah.
Can we move forward to another question or let you know?
Okay, yeah, thanks.
Okay. And sir, in terms of, say, we have done one last thing on the cost front. I mean, you have been talking about a lot of localization for last many quarters. So when we think we will start hitting some of those localization in our numbers?
We'll see that happening towards the end of this quarter.
Okay. Okay. That's all from my side, I think.
Okay, thank
whenever
you
can comfortable with this.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nishant Vas from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. So my first question is more of a clarification in terms of your product level share of business with the new, because you're obviously working a lot with the EV guys, specifically Ola, for example. How does that compare in terms of with your existing ICE OEMs, say an HMSI, for similar parts? Is the share of business with these customers higher or similar? Because it's competitive, to just get a sense of competitive intensity. And the part association question is that how are the product level specifications in terms of the product development on these parts that you are building for EV guys? Are they very different in terms of technology requirement or specification in terms of tolerances, complexity of parts? So can you share some thoughts on this?
Sure. Yeah, Nishant. So firstly, on the share of business, Ola, we are 100%. So it is far better than what it is in HMSI, because HMSI, we share business with our competition and Endurance. So that is the first part. And you said on the second part on the EV product specifications, largely they are the same. You know, in two-wheelers particularly, there is not much difference. But we are working on, you know, any innovative things that we can do for them, particularly for two-wheelers. That is still, you know, under concept stage. But it's the same shocks and front fork. But for Ola, of course, we are giving a new technology, front fork as well as rear shocks. Yes, that new technology is applicable equally to IC engines. So it's not anything specifically developed for Ola, but we can give it to anybody. So to answer your question, there is no difference in the product as such as of now. But in the cars, again, if you see the products that we are giving for Mahindra, you know, electric, I mean, in terms of, you know, their e-Verito or e-KUV, we are suppliers to them for both the platforms, very small numbers, but the shocks are the same, you know, just we had to do some minor retuning, but essentially the shocks and the struts are the same. But going forward, for a, as they call, a pure, you know, clean sheet EV or a born EV, as they say, for that, in the passenger car, there might be requirements where the noise levels have to be even better. because it's a silent car. The in-cab noise is, if you're driven a electric passenger car, it's, you know, you suddenly start hearing the noise of the AC, which you otherwise never hear in a normal car. So the sound inside the car will become very critical. So to that extent, the noise may play a part. Again, where we have some solutions.
So, sir, just to take up your associated question to your response, and you had mentioned in a previous question your response that pricing is competitive and margin is slightly better. So, is it fair to assume that with the new technology parts, your potential content per vehicle in an EV scooter, in an ideal scenario, if most of your products get adopted by a customer, is higher than your, let's say, your best IC scooter content per vehicle, or is it similar?
Yes.
And
Okay. Completely.
Okay. So, the content per vehicle is higher for if you were to able to supply all your parts to a specific customer, the content is higher on an ICE. And just to clarify, because in generally in ICE, the supply, the schedule, there is a general waterfall pricing with volume. Is it a similar construct of pricing over a longer time with the EV customers as well in terms of waterfall and vis-a-vis pricing and volume?
I didn't get that in terms of.
So waterfall price reduction. Generally, you have a price reduction linked to volume.
Okay.
In an
year-on-year reduction, as you call it, right?
Yeah. Right.
So year-on-year reduction. Again, it's all a factor of your costing. You know, when we offer, if the customer is interesting on a year-on-year, we build it in the costing. And secondly, if we give a year-on-year, we then take that. We also get the time to work on our reductions. You know, with our suppliers, with our processes, with our efficiency, to ensure that margins don't degenerate. So that's a normal process. I think there's nothing.
Okay. And so one small clarification, which is my last clarification, is that so when you talk margins are competitive or slightly better, I would assume that you're basically coming from GVA as well. The gross value add is better in that sense, probably in an EV part vis-a-vis.
Should be. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Fair enough, sir. Thank you so much for your clarification.
Thank you.
So before we move on to the next question, Priyaranjan, the answer to your question, we have 80% two-wheelers and 20% three-wheelers. And of this 80%, 60% is motorcycle.
Okay, thank you, Rishi.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Anand Shelgaonkar from Newport Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you for this opportunity. I just want to understand how the EV industry or demand would proceed over, say, the next 3 to 5 years. So my question really is, I can understand new EV makers coming up with new launches and therefore production moving up over the next 1 year, 1.5, 2 years. But from the customer demand point of view, I suspect this could be a zero-sum game, because if I buy an EV, I'm not going to buy, say, an ICE, which I would have bought otherwise. So forget the bump up in the next 1.5, 2 years, but over a 3 to 5 year period, do you think this is going to be a zero-sum game for, say, companies like Gabriel, who provides, you know, who supplies to both EVs as well as ICE?
Good question, Anand. So I think it won't be a zero-sum game, but it will not be, definitely not be a net, pure increase. There will be some cannibalization that will happen. As I said, again, there are different profiles and usages of the EVs. EVs, whatever we know, will definitely impact the intra-city customers who are, you know, commuting 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers. You know, you are seeing, just to share with you, and most of our, let's say, house helps, drivers, etc., they normally now have a, you know, scooter for commute. So those commute segment will get shifted to EV, most certainly. But the rest of the customers who are doing long distances or who use their two-wheelers as a mode of quote-unquote freight transport also, because that's very prevalent in India. And then secondly, in the rural market, where, you know, the usage is far more, the abuse is far higher. That's why you see more motorcycles in the rural market. So that segment will practically be untouched. And thirdly, what is going to happen is, you know, there are these, electric two-wheelers will give rise to a new market as well, in terms of it will increase the overall market size, because there might be some customers who just want the eco-friendly, and they may today don't have a scooter, but they may think, okay, for short distances, why don't I consider a EV scooter, so I make a statement. Those kind of customers, that will definitely give rise to an incremental market. So it's a mixed bag. I mean, no straight answer to it. Scooters will, scooters will definitely take a little bit of hit when it comes to EVs, city scooters.
Right. So, sir, but most of the examples that you quoted, they still seem to be explaining how the shift would happen, but it's not very clear how the pie would grow bigger. So I still continue to believe that maybe over a 5-year period, the volumes for somebody like a Gabriel or total volumes of scooters may have been similar.
It will still be a little higher. Now the pie getting bigger, even in the current stage, there are these low speed scooters which don't need a license. Like we are also supplying to them. They don't need a license as such. They travel only up to 30 km/h. So that obviously, you know, is catering to a different market in terms of age or those who don't want a license at all. So that's creating a totally new market. So that's why I said, so those numbers might be totally purely incremental. Yes, this will peter down over the long term. Over the long term, these customers may not be many. But still, I would say, I have not still seen any research on this front as to how much cannibalization will happen. But I still believe there will be an overall increase in the market. And the impact will not, you'll not see it in motorcycle segment, almost nothing.
Understood. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Saurabh Shroff. The line for the current participant just got disconnected. Participants, to ask a question, you may press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Shashank from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good morning, sir, and thanks for the opportunity. So firstly, just wanted to ask if you can share some color about the ramp up at Ola Electric. So what kind of volumes are they targeting for the next 6 months or a year kind of thing?
Sorry, Shashank, right?
Yes.
Yeah, Shashank. So I will not be able to share the volumes because we obviously sign a confidentiality agreement with them. But you're seeing in the papers, so that the ramp up even in this year is gradual. They're mainly starting from, let's say, from month of September onwards, picking up steam in December, January, and then next year they would definitely want to hit that 1 million what they have planned.
So we are not short of capacity, right?
Pardon?
We are not short of any capacities, right? So
No. We are making some minor investments for incremental capacities, which we have already done.
Okay. Second, sir, what will be the capex spend for this year and next year? Ballpark numbers.
Rishi?
Yep. Shashank, for this year, it will be in the range of 100 odd crores.
Okay. 100 crores, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so lastly, you have a vision of being the top 5 guys globally. Within, you intend to do it by inorganic route as well. So, sir, any progress on that front or any color that you'd like to share?
Well, we are in the process of scanning. Couple of opportunities. Currently, it's ongoing. We can only share once it matures to a certain extent.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much, and wish you all the best.
Thank you. Thank you, Sean.
Thank you. The next one is from the line of Saurabh Shroff from QRC Investment Advisors. Please go ahead.
Yes, hi. Thanks for taking my question. So we are just coming back to margins. So, as we look at your last 10-12 quarter numbers, obviously what is commendable is that between employee and other expenses, it sort of stayed in a band of 80 to 90 crores across a wide range of sort of revenue outcomes, even if you were to consider the first quarter of last year, which was pretty much a washout. Can you help quantify for us what is the rupee amount of cost reduction that you have managed to do, just so that we better appreciate the operating leverage that you spoke of as one of the margin levers?
Sorry, I lost you in between. Can you repeat that?
So I'm saying that, you know, just looking at your quarterly numbers for the last 10-12 quarters, between employee expenses and other expenses, it's been a sort of very tight range of 80 to 90 crores, which is very commendable because the revenue outcomes have been all from 300 crores to 550 crores. Just so that we can appreciate better, what is the quantum of cost that you have taken out, so that we can better appreciate what the operating leverage sitting in the business is, because you mentioned that as probably one of the more important levers. Because to me, when I look at it, it looks like all of the margin hit that we have seen is primarily because of raw material inflation. Not just for two quarters, but even across 3 years. So when things normalize, and let us say we go back to that 27-28% gross margin, how much is the EBITDA lift that we could get?
Yeah, so I think Rishi, are able to, I mean, on the screen, you're shown that, right?
No, so, that is only for us to look at. So Saurabh, again on the fixed overhead piece, yes, we will be running this 490 for the last 2 years now, and this is the third year. So we've had considerable amount of benefit arising out of that program. I'll be able to give you a percentage range of benefit from between 1-2% is what we've been able to manage on account of fixed overhead. On the manpower side, again, with the increments coming in and thereafter normalizing, we should be able to sustain at the current percentage levels.
Okay, sorry, I've missed the number on the overhead front. How much is it? What percentage?
1-2%.
1-2%. Okay, that's great. Okay, that's it from my side. Thank you. And sorry, one final thing. What is the utilization level that you are running at right now?
Right now, you know, our I think practically all the plants, I mean, Khandsa plant, which caters to Maruti, is, you know, running at 80% almost. We are seeing even two-wheeler plants running at similar 70-75% capacities. Only Deva's plant, which is commercial vehicle, that is running at, I would say, 55, around that range. But the rest are pretty much, 70-80%.
And the sweet spot, I guess, for the overhead absorption is anything above 90%?
Yeah, I mean, above 90% will be a stretch, but 90% also will be very good.
Okay, excellent. Thank you very much, and all
Thank
the
you.
Best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The last question is from the line of Romit Nagpal, an individual investor. Please go ahead. Mr. Romit Nagpal, your line is unmuted. Please go ahead with your question. Mr. Nagpal, sir, I would request you to unmute yourself if muted from the handset. There is no response from the line of the current participant. As there are no further questions, I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Kolatkar for closing comments.
Thank you. So thank you once again for all those queries. I mean, hopefully we're able to answer most of them. Yes, I can see a lot of interest around EV, but as we say, it's an evolving space. Even between last quarter to this quarter, there has been a significant change. There have been two significant change points. One is the FAME II, and the second is the fuel price crossing the mental barrier of 100. So, you know, it's a segment which is literally evolving by the day. So we also have to be closely in touch with our eyes and ears on the ground, and do the best. So the best strategy that we have adopted is to stay close to the customer. Which way, which customer is going to win, is anybody's guess. But yeah, I mean, the strategy is clear as far as we are concerned. Coming to the rest of the market, certainly the only big if which I mentioned is while the volumes look robust, the the passenger car demand seems really very, very strong. Two-wheeler also is reasonably strong. CV is going to pick up. The only if is the third wave. Let's hope, you know, we do not see a major disruption, and let's hope that we do not see impact on health of people of the entire country. So that's the only hope that I have. That's about all that I have to share. So since this is the call also that we will have, you know, the next call will be only post the festive season. I wish all of you a very, very happy, safe, healthy festive season. And would just urge and caution everybody to still keep their, you know, guards up and stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. On behalf of Gabriel India, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.